So now that we talked about the first colonists on Mars, the independence of Mars, and how future Martians might evolve, it's time to speculate about the far future. How would a Martian economy look? For example, in the year 2100.
What could Mars manufacture and export? And what kind of machinery and technology would Martians need in order to accomplish that? This could get interesting, so stay tuned.
Welcome to the fourth and also last part of our collaboration with the Angry Astronaut. In the first video, the Angry Astronaut talked about the first colonists on Mars and what skill sets they would need to have in order to build up the first successful colony. In the second video, we talked about how Mars could become independent from Earth at some point. In the third video, Angry Astronaut talked about how future Martians would evolve and if they could maybe become a new race of humans. Of course, the links to all these videos will be in the description below. And please visit Angry Astronaut's channel and subscribe to him because he makes really excellent and entertaining videos on all space-related topics. And of course, he's just as outspoken and non-PC as us. Okay, so in today's video, we'd like to speculate about how the Martian economy might evolve in the future. And by that, we mean in the far future.
As we've established in the first three videos of the collaboration, Mars would at first be dependent from Earth and would thus not yet have its own economy. Okay, so the first settlers will arrive on Mars hopefully around 2030, depending of course on how fast SpaceX will be able to get Starship flying reliably. And those settlers will start building up the first base camps. Even more ideally, autonomous robots will have already built the first base camp even before the first settlers arrive. These bases will be quite small in the beginning. A few habitat shelters, probably covered by Martian regolith in order to protect against solar and cosmic rays, as for example in this concept here, by the companies Hassel and EOC. Here, expandable habitat modules are being surrounded by a 3D printed regolith dome-like structure which filters out almost all of the solar and the largest part of the highly energetic cosmic radiation. Therefore, the argument that Martian settlers will have to endure large amounts of radiation is a false argument. This argument is mostly thrown around by opponents of human settlement of the solar system and by uninformed media outlets. This would only be the case if the Martian colonists would spend 24/7 outside of the habitat in their spacesuits, which actually percentage-wise would not be the case very often. Probably a maximum of 5-10% of the time would be spent in extravehicular activities. The surface radiation of Mars is around 230 millisieverts per year, and the lifetime safety limit is 1 sievert. The radiation in the habitat is negligible, so the settlers would reach their lifetime dosage limit probably earliest after around 40 years, depending on how much time they spend outside of the base. Anyways, so as Starship travel to Mars becomes more common and more base camps are being established, the first cities will start growing.
And please subscribe to our channel, because we not only make space videos regularly, but also videos on all other disruptive technologies. However, the YouTube algorithm really doesn't like it when we cover so many different topics. So your support really helps a lot, and thanks so much in advance. The first city on Mars will probably start as an agglomeration of a few base camps, or from a single larger base camp. How this city will exactly look is anyone's guess. It could be a large dome structure, which would be beneficial for the psychological well-being because of sunlight. And of course, energetically, because the sun would warm up the structure like a giant greenhouse. Also, you could build an open city like here on Earth, with regular streets, buildings, and gardens. And you would also find large open spaces like in the cities on Earth. But of course, the downside is the vulnerability towards meteorite impacts. Or the first city on Mars could be built into canyon walls. You know, kind of like Venus Wheel from Total Recall, which was also built into canyon walls. But hopefully this will be the only similarity with Total Recall. Of course, we could also go for the safe route and build large underground cities in the huge lava tubes and caves on Mars. This would be the safest option, but obviously might not be ideal from a psychological perspective. No matter what form the first Mars city will have, we can be quite sure that once a city forms, it will not remain the only city. Multiple cities will be forming in the second half of the 21st century. Again, of course, under the premise that SpaceX's Mars colonization plans will go more or less as planned. And we should always remember that delays will happen. And we can call ourselves extremely lucky if we have the first city on Mars by the year 2050. Then, towards the end of the 21st century, we might already see a few cities on Mars, and they will be connected by an interplanetary Hyperloop network. The coolest thing is that on Mars, you basically get free Hyperloops. All you have to do is to dig underground tunnels, and they are already almost evacuated. Isn't that awesome? Whereas on Earth, Hyperloops will have to be evacuated using lots of vacuum pumps. On Mars, the atmospheric density being only 0.6% that of Earth, the energy demand will be a lot lower since you won't need those vacuum pumps. Also, since the temperature on Mars is a lot lower than on Earth, it might be possible to employ next-generation high-temperature superconductors to have frictionless magnetic high-speed Hyperloop travel. That is high temperature in the sense of temperatures where nitrogen is liquid, so -196 degrees Celsius or 77 kelvins and above. This would employ the Meissner-Ochsenfeld effect of superconductivity, which would make the Hyperloop trains magnetically float in the Hyperloop tunnels almost completely frictionless, therefore consuming very little energy. How convenient then that metal ores on Mars include niobium, a metal used in producing superconductors and specialty steels, lanthanum and neodymium, and europium for monitors and energy-efficient LED lights.
Moreover, magnesium, aluminium, titanium, of course iron, and chromium are relatively common on Mars. In addition, lithium, cobalt, nickel, copper, zinc, tungsten, and even gold have been found in trace amounts. It is quite likely that in some places, these materials are concentrated enough to be mined economically. Mars has a giant advantage compared to Earth. Because of the much lower gravity that is only 38% of Earth's, the future Martians could build a space elevator much more easily than would be the case on Earth. So once ore mining would be established on a planet-wide basis and factories would process these ores, the future Martians might start building a space elevator at some point. Because of the lower gravity, but similar rotation period as Earth, the material strain would be a lot lower than in the case of Earth. We therefore wouldn't need carbon nanotubes to build a Mars space elevator, but steel wiring or Kevlar wiring will suffice. This would open up super cheap access to orbit for Martians, and therefore Mars could establish a very strong export-oriented economy. Every surplus mineral that would be discovered and be abundant on Mars, but rare on Earth, such as some of the aforementioned rare earth minerals, might be exported to Earth using the space elevator and whatever type of spacecraft will be used by then to ferry cargo and people between Earth and Mars, possibly large cyclers with nuclear thermal propulsion. In any case, Mars could establish a strong export-oriented economy. Even more so, because Mars has another giant advantage compared to Earth. It is much nearer to the asteroid belt. Therefore, once asteroid mining is more common, asteroids from the belt could be redirected towards Mars and mined in Mars orbit. Automated factories would process the mined minerals, and thus orbital shipyards would be much easier to realize at Mars than at Earth. So, Utopia Planitia shipyards after all? You know, where the USS Enterprise D will be built in the year 2363. So it very well might be that Star Trek is right in that regard, namely that Mars will have large orbital shipyards exactly because of that unique combination of low gravity, which enables a space elevator, and being near to the asteroid belt at the same time. Mars could therefore not only become a larger exporter of some rare earth minerals, but also be the main shipbuilding force of the solar system. When humanity will have established other colonies in the outer solar system, these colonies might very well order their ships from Mars and not from Earth. So will this lead inevitably to a giant conflict between Earth and Mars, now that we found that Mars might be able to build large spaceships fleets in the future?
Not so fast, because we shouldn't forget that Earth has the Moon. And the Moon, with its vast resources and metals, will also allow Earth to build quite massive ship fleets in lunar orbit. Ores harvested on the Moon will be processed into ship parts, shot up into lunar orbit by a lunar railgun. And therefore the Earth-Moon system will also have the capability to build large fleets. But we are pretty sure that most of these fleets will be unarmed, since in the future as well as now, trade will enable a lot more long-term growth and profit than war. Why fight unnecessary wars when you can trade and thus increase your wealth, while at the same time achieving a win-win scenario? In the current globalized world, you can already see a growing trend towards fighting economic wars instead of real wars in case of conflict. Sanctions have become more often the weapon of choice instead of the brute force approach. Humans are becoming more peaceful as time passes. This is a historical trend that has been happening since the Stone Age, and we assume that it will continue into the future. Therefore, we believe that a scenario as in the sci-fi series The Expanse is not very realistic. If in the future we still behave like such assholes as in The Expanse, then honestly, we haven't deserved to survive as a species.
So we assume that the Earth-Moon system, Mars, and the other colonies of the solar system will be very interconnected. Today we are speaking of globalization, the phenomenon that the world is interconnected regarding trade, the flow of information, labor, culture, and more. In the future, we might witness a solar systemization, where the large players in the solar system will be acting as autonomous entities with a very interconnected economy. So Mars, for example, might be the big ship and rare earth metal exporter of the solar system, whereas the Earth might become the tourist attraction of the solar system. Because for a very long time, we will have oceans, rivers, and forests only on Earth. Of course, when terraforming will happen, that might change. But this will happen in the even further future.
So Mars will play a very important role in this interconnected solar system economy, and might become the heavy industries exporter of the solar system. This in turn will mean a prospering Martian economy. So, if you want to become a billionaire in the far future, it will probably be a lot easier to achieve in the growing economy of Mars than in the saturated economy here on Earth.
As always, we'd like to thank all the people that help us with the channel. This is of course Zabol Chiare, Michael Rood, Jay King, Stefan van der Feest,
Another Space Nut, Miko, Rich LB, Framrick, Based Space Boris, MLLT, Warhawk, Lucky Green, and Centauri Sparrow.
You guys are really awesome. Thank you so much for your help.
By the way, we organize everything for this channel here on our Discord server. So if you also want to join the team, be sure to use the invite link in the video description below.
And if you missed our previous Martian collaboration series with the Angry Astronaut, you can watch them right here. So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future.
9!
Kopf zerknüpfen!
Genau, jetzt müssen Sie googeln, was Kopf zerknüpfen heißt.